until the philosophy which owed one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned. Everywhere is war. It's a war that until there are no longer first class and second class citizens of any nation, until the color of a man's skin is of no more significance than the color of his eyes. Miss a war that until the basic human rights are equally guaranteed to all.
The issue before us, as Bob Marley suggests, is the question of war. Is there a war in the East? Is there a war in the West? Is there a war in the South? And is there a war in the North? And those of us who live in this country have to decide that issue basically within the next few years. Because from all the computer projections, it is clear that war is imminent. Now, for those of us who want to try and understand why we are going to the gas chambers, it's important to, first of all, know what are the journals we can read? What can we do to understand this phenomenon of war? And most of us as citizens are unable to have a grasp on this problem, primarily because the journals that inform us are journals that are primarily concerned with telling us scientifically and through computer projections what are the prospects of how many people will be killed, what cities will be blown up, what individuals will die, and most importantly, how can we survive after that war. So that as intellectuals, we have to turn to journals like Foreign Affairs. It's the most powerful, most influential journal in this country. The spring issue tells us, for example, about mastering the world economy. It begins with the following paragraph. Does a global economy exist? Question mark. If one were to base one's opinion or one's judgment solely on the recent meeting of the world's most powerful decision makers, whether in Geneva, Versailles, or Cancun, the answer will be no. Now, most of us, when we read these journals, try to ask ourselves a question. Can there be a world in which there can be peace and economic, if you wish, justice or redistribution of the globe, of the resources of the world? I would suggest, first of all, if one reads the variety of journals that one comes across, whether it is Foreign Affairs or now the most powerful journal in Washington, called the Washington Quarterly, the Review of Strategic and International Issues. It's the journal published, I believe, by Georgetown University, where most of the unemployed academics find employment. Now, if you read those journals, you would come to the conclusion that war is an industry, and writing about war is the most important industry in the world today. Now, writing about war requires us, for example, to look at, if you look at any of these journals, What are we going to do with parts of the world where we can experiment for the next few years? Now, what do we mean by that? I mean basically that the globe has become an experimental zone. We have experimented in Korea, we experimented in Japan a few years ago. We will now experiment in Vietnam. Maybe we can experiment in the Middle East, maybe in South Africa. So that if you look at the industry, what I call the intellectual industry of war, we have produced a variety of journals where the best minds of the world are now trying to explain to us why should we go to this Holocaust. Now, they're not interested in avoiding it. Look at, you know, the journals I brought before you. I can hardly find a journal that's devoted to peace. Peace studies or peace journals or a peace institute is really the activity of naive, stupid people, real intellectuals, people who are really brilliant, are people who can understand and explain strategic problems. How can we destroy a village right to the point whereby everybody is destroyed so that nobody can survive to conduct the guerrilla war? Now, the question is, when we read these journals, are we trying to produce a generation of intellects who can explain not just war, but most importantly, how precisely we can destroy the human personality? And therefore, if you turn around and look at the journals that I have tried to, if you wish, lead you through tonight, I want to say that as a student of politics, I find very few journals that give me a sense of hope or an alternative to war. Let's take this very important alternative that came up, a journal called Foreign Policy to Foreign Affairs. Now, this is not to argue that these journals are designed just for propagating war, but because they are so obsessed with describing the contemporary reality, none of them are willing to experiment about alternatives. And when Foreign Policy came on the scene, I sighed a little. I said, thank God, at last we can now look at an option, an alternative. But then, here again, I found that one looked through this very elegant thing that you could put in your pocket. This you can't put in your pocket. This is obviously a journal of great learning, great study. It requires somebody with an enormous study to sit back and relax and look at the journal. The size itself says something. Now, why the size? Why the size? The reason for the size is the necessity to consciously obscure the world of reality. Intellectuals are involved in the task of obscuring reality because we earn our living by being obscure. Because if we are simple and precise and obvious, as I used to say to my Caribbean students, if you are that smart, you will be simple. If you are stupid, you'll be obscure. Obscurity is the essence of the scientific effort to destroy the capacity of people to understand reality in a fundamental sense. Now, what do I mean by that? I simply mean that there is a conspiracy of knowledge. Knowledge is being turned into such an obscure phenomenon that the ordinary citizen feels foreign affairs is not their business. Foreign affairs is for the experts. Foreign affairs is for the elite. So if you look at the journals I have brought before you, they are the journals of the elite. They are the journals that are designed primarily to make sure that people do not understand the reality around them. We began our program with a reggae by Bob Marley, who said, there's a war in the east, there's a war in the south, there's a war in the west, and there's a war in the north. Now, this reggae simply attempts, in the language of a poet that Bob Marley is, he says, look, the world is insane. Unless we stop war and develop a science of understanding why we are going to war, there is no way we as a humanity, as a people, can survive. So ultimately, if you look at these journals, they do not enable you to understand the reality, but consciously attempt to distort reality so that in that obscurantism we will end up as individuals who will throw up our hands and say, we cannot understand complexity, therefore we cannot stop war. Now, let us look at the alternative. I have brought a number of journals here tonight that suggest alternatives. The peace journals that I wanted to bring for your program insisted that I should not show them to you. Because they said, look, we are not in the business of commerce. Because we are involved in trying to inform people how to survive. Now, there's a church journal called the Washington Office on Latin America. It's a very thin journal. It's called an update. You can fold it up and you can put it into such a corner that you could almost throw it away. But yet, if you open up this journal, it says Washington Office on Latin America, El Salvador furniture sale, marking it up to mark it down. It's a brilliantly written article. It's a masterpiece. It's worth all the weight of scholarly journals. Why? Because it comes up with absurd conclusions of the following order. It says, for example, and I want to find the exact quotation, it says on Salvador, for example, that the effects in Salvador of an actual dollar amount finally approved in closed-door Washington negotiations are unlikely to prove as lasting as the political costs incurred in securing these funds. Having chosen to associate itself directly with this latest escalation, the White House must now battle public opinion, a skeptical Congress, and its own inability to present a coherent and consistent explanation for why the war effort and democracy are floundering in El Salvador. What are they trying to tell us? You know, this church group is saying, look, ultimately it's a moral question. It's a moral question. You have to decide where you are. If I read these other journals, they leave me in scientific obscurity. That is, they do not enable me to act on what I understand. Because basically the task of most of these journals is not to lead us into action, but primarily to convince us it is impossible for you peasants and backward people to ever understand the complexity. Therefore, it is best that you stay away from things you don't understand. Now, the reason I state this is because one of my colleagues and friends, Professor Richard Falk, who is at Princeton University, attempted now to change the character of interpreting world politics, and he says, look, let's start a new journal called Alternatives. And he says, okay, it's a journal of world policy. Let's see whether we can get a group of people who see the globe. Let's see the world. Let's not try and see that little bit of Wisconsin or Minnesota that we accidentally were born in. Let's try and appreciate the fact that we've got to live with the Indians, the Chinese, the Russians, the Italians, and the like. Now, if you look at these journals, there is another problem. The problem being, who are you going to reach? Look at the cost of these journals. Try and look at the price. $3.75 a copy. If you look at all these journals that I brought before you, you will discover that they are out of the reach of the ordinary citizen. The man in Harlem, the woman in Pretoria, she's not going to spend $3.75 on a journal to give her an understanding of what world politics. So that today we have to ask ourselves the question, is foreign policy primarily an elite activity? Is it the activity of those people who went to the finest university and a policy, an activity that is not for the ordinary people? If you look at the activities in Congress, if you look at the congressmen, and I've tried to talk to a number of them, and they will tell you one of the things that concerns them most is, look at the activities in Congress. If you look at the congressmen, and I've tried to talk to a number of them, and they will tell you one of the things that concerns them most is that foreign policy is not a priority for the majority of the American people. Now, why did that occur? Because, you know, we're buying the Japanese cars, we're buying the Italian shoes and on so on and so forth. But the reason why foreign policy has been removed from the public discussion is because foreign policy is something that the majority of people are affected by, but they are told that they have no decision over. Let's take the question of going to war. Going to war is no ordinary matter. Going to war is sacrificing the future of the human race. And therefore, it becomes imperative for us, who live in a democratic society to study foreign policy. And yet, foreign policy is not something that is part and parcel of our daily life. Now, I'd like to turn your attention to looking at the foreign policy establishment. Who is it? Who makes the decisions and the like? Again, the a local press here produced a journal called, or rather a book called, The Imperial Brains Trust. It argues, for example, that foreign policy matters are not matters that affect just the elite, but the activities of the elite affect a large number of people who normally would not participate. Now, let's, and foreign policy matters. Let's take, for example, the journal TransAfrica, again, that I was not allowed to bring here. The journal TransAfrica is a new foreign policy journal produced by a number of Afro-American intellectuals who say, look, America is not a country where the foreign affairs can be determined by an elite. We, the Afro-American people, have a right to participate in what is happening not only in Africa, but throughout the world. So the journal TransAfrica comes out and suggests the following. It says, we require a new policy in Southern Africa. So I look in through my journals and say, okay, what journal is going to talk and argue about Southern Africa? And then I look and find again, Foreign Affairs, South Africa, a strategy for a change. And I find Professor Croker, a very distinguished political scientist, laying before us what the policy on Southern Africa is. Now, the question that has to be asked is how come that the conventional journals of foreign affairs do not find it possible to have Afro-Americans, Hispanics, and ordinary minority groups to participate in the grand debate about the alternatives for America. Now, how come, if you look through a lot of these journals, you will find very few people with different perspectives attempting to interpret foreign affairs? I would argue primarily because there is a conscious policy to remove foreign policy from democratic debate. Because unless we are willing to discuss foreign affairs as a matter of what we talk in our dining room table, or when I turn in my subway and turn to my neighbor and say, what do you think is happening in Nicaragua? That, it seems to me, is the essence of democracy. When we can turn to our neighbor, whether he's black, white, yellow, male, female, and say to one another, what is the kind of world we live in? Because democracy essentially means not only surviving in the immediate environment in which we were born, but more importantly, in the global village that we are all part of, whether we like it or not.